Tonight we begin with a series of talks. Will probably run on for several months throughout the summer. But I finish it up in the summer, at the end of the summer. A text that purportedly date to 8th century. A Chan text. By Chan Master Yongjia Xuanjue. Are you providing the subtitles? Okay, good. Okay, good. This is one of the extraordinary texts that defined the position. Chan Buddhism. So, just a little background about this text. The author. Well, normally, in the popularized version of Chan Zen literature that you find in, you know, bookstores, online, you get this image of iconoclasm, beating, shouting, seemingly irrational acts, Chan masters, and people getting awakened left and right. But if we just look at that phase, development of Chan, really can't appreciate actions, extemporaneous dialogues, and skillful means. Why? Because we have no context. Everything is contextual. If we were to look at the historical development of Chan, what preceded the emergence of the Chan tradition is what I call Buddhist scholasticism. This is a phase running several centuries from the 2nd to the 6th centuries. Where translations are still ongoing, and from Sanskrit, Chinese, and Chinese Buddhists are still trying to fathom what Buddha taught. The first, it tried to understand Buddhism from the lens of Taoism. And it discovered that this teaching is radically different from indigenous Chinese thinking. And the core of the scholasticism began probably around the 4th century. But you understand Buddhism from India, Central Asia, on their own terms, instead of matching concepts. By that time, better translations were available. And it was in this context, extensive philosophical inquiries and theoretical exegesis through words, language, categories, concepts, that Chan emerged as a counter to prevalence of how Buddhism was approached. Hence, it focuses on direct experiencing, as opposed to words and language, conceptual understanding. So once Buddhism was really understood, then what came next was the embodiment of this teaching. And if we look at the historical development of Chan itself, all the different texts, writings, this particular text, the teacher translated as Song of Enlightenment. Could be variously translated as Song of Actualizing the Way. So that's probably a more literal translation. This text, along with the Platform Sutra, along with not too many, maybe one or two other short poems, really defined Chan squarely within the Mahayana tradition, sutra-based, doctrinally sound, that set the premise what came later in the Chan tradition in China. This is way before it went to Japan, came Zen. So this period is what I call the foundational period of Chan. What came next could be said to be the indigenization, routinization of this teaching embodied through the actions and words of Chan masters. That is where you get the kind of popularized image of Chan Zen teachers shouting, beating, and so on. Pushing the student to awakening, or providing the context, the catalyst for seeing the self nature. In that period, the first we have the foundational phase. Second phase, that period, I would call it the period of routinization, indigenization, becoming Chinese, leaving behind all the technical terms that still can be found in Chan, you know, foundational period text during that time. Terms like samadhi, terms like nirvana, terms like Tathagata Garba, even all these evidence of Indic Buddhism. So the second phase, you find no evidence of that. There's no theorization. There's simply recordings of the embodiment of what was established in the first phase. Historically, as Chinese becoming personally experienced gaining the spiritual fulfillment. The Mahayana teachings, personally testifying, verifying teachings, their subsequent actions. It is during this second phase that because it relinquished evidence of Indic terminologies, notions, and idea went back to the Chinese expressions, articulation of the path. Nirvana is substituted by the way, Tao, right, Chinese terms. So on the superficial level, you know, some scholars and writers think that Chan Buddhism is basically Taoism. That's because these people don't understand. Even though the terms used were kind of indigenous Chinese notions, but the implications is completely different. So it's like trying to understand something from the superficial layer and not understanding the core. The richness of these implications. So that would be the second phase. The third phase would be probably 12th century, 11, maybe late 10th to 11th, 12th century onward. The emergence of indigenous, you know, fully Chinese methods of practice, quite unique. Although the principle of the method can be traced back to India, but the expressions of that, very unique, very uniquely Chinese. And here I'm talking about the method of silent illumination and Gong An Hua Tou. So if you want to know more about that, you can find out in my teacher's writings or my writings, or just Google them, those of you who are not well versed in that. So, because this text is so foundational, it's worth our while to explore the profundity of this text to understand what Chan practice is all about. How is it distinct from other forms of and expressions of Buddhism? Then we will be able to appreciate the actions of the Chan masters, how they actually embody the teaching in the midst of daily life, in the interactions with people. How does a teacher in the pre-modern time, second phase, teach the students under what circumstances? They say certain things. And then you'll be able to discern how they bring delusion to death and wisdom to life. This is referring to the killing method and the bringing to life of the actions, the teachings of Chan masters. So these two approaches help students, and everything in between, helps students to navigate to their spiritual path. Exploration of who they are, their mind. So the attachments, their hang-ups, how to sever those. Their potentials, their insight, how to foster them. And each student is unique. So these actions and teachings unhinged, unbounded, no longer bounded by technical Buddhist terms and jargon, completely embodied in everyday life. And how those interactions, if we want to understand what koans are, gong'an, how those interactions later became formulated into methods of practice, methods of contemplation. So it's all related, these different phases of development, but without the foundational phase, which this text embodies, very difficult to understand the teachings of Chan. Right? You just get snippets or fragments of it. And if you try to piece together them by yourself through your own thinking, it's completely wrong. So that's about the text. Now about Yongjia Xuanjue. Now his name is Xuanjue. He's from Yongjia. So he was born in Zhejiang province and left home when he was 7, I believe. Very intelligent boy, very sincere, diligently studied with several teachers. And of course, at that time, we're talking about 7th, 8th century, beginning of 8th century. I think his dates are 655 to 713, something like that. So this is a time in the development of Chinese Buddhism when Chan Buddhism is really just emerging as regional expressions of Buddhism. So it's not nationally recognized yet. So what was nationally recognized? What was the mainstream? Mainstream was Tiantai Buddhism. So him, he was a Tiantai Buddhist monk. Tiantai Buddhism was the first form of Buddhism that systematized all the Indian, Central Asian doctrinal expressions of Buddhism and the soteriological, the path of liberation, right? The practice dimensions of most famously Shamatha Vipassana. He was able to systematize these methods of practice, so trained as a boy through the practice of Shamatha Vipassana, schooled in the Tiantai doctrinal rich doctrinal teachings within Buddhism. He was, you could say, self-enlightened. He had no fixed teachers, though he studied with some of the most prominent teachers at the time. For example, he studied with Zhi Yi, which is the fourth patriarch of the Tiantai school. Now, the whole Tiantai school was basically systematized by Zhi Yi. Even though he was fourth patriarch, basically he was the founder. Okay? So he studied with Zhi Yi. He studied with and was kind of friends with many of Zhi Yi's disciples, and one of which became the fifth patriarch. And so he was in the circle of these Tiantai practitioners. So you could say there was no really kind of widespread teaching of Chan at that point. But how was he enlightened? You know, after understanding the Tiantai teaching, Tiantai teachings systematized, you know, all the Indian Buddhist teachings plus existing Chinese absorption of those Indian teachings. So the teachings came into China in a random way, really. You know, sutras were translated in an unsystematized way. So it was the Tiantai teaching that kind of systematized them. And when he read, you know, after decades of study, when he and practice, when he read the Vimalakirti Sutra, which had an extremely important impact on the emergence of Chan Buddhism. There's only a small handful of sutras that really influenced, impacted Chan. You have the Lankadavara Sutra, the Diamond Sutra, the Vimalakirti Sutra, maybe parts of the Lotus Sutra. So, when he read the Vimalakirti Sutra, all of his doubts shattered. And he entered the knowing and the experiencing of the Buddhas. But there was no one to verify him. So around 40s, maybe early 40s, he met a disciple of the sixth patriarch of Chan, sixth ancestral master. But Chan at that time was just a southern regional form and expression of Buddhism, limited to just a few communities, right? He met a disciple of the sixth patriarch, and who was just astonished by Xuanjue's understanding, and encouraged him to visit Huinen down south with the sixth patriarch. And he decided to take up advice. This, upon seeing Huinen, it was such an astonishing interaction. That's actually featured in the Platform Sutra, which is attributed to Huinen. Their encounter. So, upon seeing Huinen, Xuanjue circumambulated him three times, but did not bow, did not pay full reverence. This was he's got some balls, okay? So to an elder, you know, acharya, you know, you don't demonstrate this. So here comes the encounter dialogue, right? That kind of challenge, Dharma combat. So he says, circumambulated three times, he says. And then Huinen says, where are you from? He says, such an arrogant monk. Don't even demonstrate the basic decorum of a monk. And Xuanjue responded right away. Says, birth and death. This great matter of birth. Don't quote me on this, but I'm paraphrasing, okay? So it says, impermanence is swift. This great matter of birth and death is of utmost importance. There's no time for mere decorum. So, Wei Nan responded. When you experience no birth and no death, then there's no swiftness. And then Yongjia responded right away. Says, upon realizing the Dharma body, there's no more birth and death. Something like that. And then Wei Nan was delighted. It's excellent. Very good. Now, and then Yongjia says, I'll take my leave now. So he is ready to split, right? And Wei Nan says, why leave so soon? Says, in birth and death, there is no soon or not soon. So the combat continues, right? And Wei Nan smiled and says, if there's no soon or not soon, who's perceiving that? Xuanjue responded, you're the one who's discerning soon and not soon. And then Wei Nan responded by saying, even that being so, you can stay overnight here. Getting late, right? So there was some other conversation beyond that. Can't remember exactly. Check out the Platform Sutra. Right, there are several translations floating on the internet. And then he became known as the one-night stand Chan master. Yisuque. So, now the Platform Sutra is the teaching of Wei Nan. The teachings were so profound that to the Chinese, they named it a sutra on par with all the Indian sutras. Right? So it's not a discourse record or teachings by so-and-so. It's actually the Platform Sutra. Now, that Platform Sutra really features Hui Nan and his teachings. The only other person that had this, you know, extemporaneous dialogue was Xuanjue. So after that, you know, he stayed one night and he took his leave. And he became quite well known among different communities of meditators, yogis. And people kind of flocked to him. But he didn't live too long. Basically died at the peak of his life. So he died in his late 40s. A Chan teacher's peak. Usually, the late 40s to kind of early 50s. This is the peak period of a Chan master's teaching. You know, provided that they've been practicing for you know, several decades before that. But he kind of passed away. He passed away quite early in his life. Nonetheless, he left with us this poem, Song of Actualizing the Way. Actualizing the Way. So I have this translation. It's modified by my teacher's earlier translation. Just some areas. But not only this, he also left with two other works, never been translated. One of these days, I'll translate them. It's called the Song of Shamatha. Oh, actually three. Song of Shamatha, Song of Vipassana, and Song of Samapatti. Samapatti. All excellent works. Grounding and synthesizing the Tiantai teachings expressed through personal embodiment awakening. So, so it's in that sense, it's unlike a typical Tiantai work, very doctrinal and so on. Okay. So we're going to go section by section. Now, one thing I have to say is, you know, this text comes to us before printing. So we're talking about manuscript culture. You know, the Chinese invented printing in the 9th century, the earliest printing press in the world. And the first text was Buddhist text on Prajnaparamita, right? So just imagine. So the Buddhist, is a side note, the Buddhist has always been technologically very savvy. In pre-modern times too, they're the first one who invented, you know, printing. So this text comes to us in manuscript, through manuscript culture. That means people copied it, not widely circulated. And it is in the canon, but it took several centuries to do that. Now, this is 8th century, 9th century. You know, it wasn't included, you know, in different editions of the Buddhist canon. So throughout this period of, you know, hand copying, there are some textual interpolations here, meaning, you know, things are added, things are deleted, all kinds of stuff. But there are some passages that are inconsistent. Now, I haven't decided what I will give commentary to the complete text. This text is quite long, so I'll probably do excerpts. Because clearly, some parts are inconsistent with his teachings. For example, in this text, he advocates, you know, being practiced in solitary solitude in the mountains, much better than mingling with people. That's actually probably not his thinking, because in other works that he has produced, written, you see that his view on Chan is on meditation practice diametrically opposed to that. He advocated practice in the midst of daily life while interacting with people. And so that's probably one area of interpolation that later people added. You know, there are some other parts, and when we get to them, I'll highlight them, or I may just skip them. So let me read the text to you. Tonight, I'll just read a few passages. The text goes, "Have you not seen the person of the way who has nothing to learn, nothing to do? He neither discards wandering thoughts nor seek the truth. The true nature of fundamental ignorance is Buddha nature. This illusory empty body is the Dharma body. After realizing the Dharma body, there's not a single thing. The original source of self nature is the original innocent Buddha. The five skandhas, the empty comings and goings of floating clouds, three poisons, the vacant appearing and disappearing of bubbles. When genuine reality is actualized, there's neither person nor Dharma. In a kshana instant, the avicii hell, karma, are destroyed. If I lie to deceive sentient beings, may my tongue be ripped out for kalpas, uncountable as dust sand. When sudden awakening to Tathagata's chan, the six paramitas and the myriad means are perfected in their essence. In dreams, there are clearly six destinies of sentient beings. Upon awakening, great Chiliocosm is completely empty. There is no transgression or merit, no loss or gain. Do not seek for anything in the nature of quiescent extinction. The dusty mirror has never been polished. Today, it must be clearly explored and discerned. Stop here. It's today's day. Several terms here. This section, I will call it clarifying the view. Clarifying the view. What kind of view? The view of Buddha Dharma from the perspective of awakening. Now, a lot of people are confused with the view and the practice. The principle and the lived experience. So when they come across teachings like this, five skandhas are empty, the three poisons are like bubbles. There are no six realms of existence, samsara. There is no merit. No gain, no loss. Sometimes people come across teachings that talks about, you know, inseparability of samsara and nirvana. This is what this view is highlighting here. What we reify as samsara and all the practices that is taught in the world of causes and conditions. This is what is called conventional teachings. And when people come across this, the inseparability of conventional and the ultimate teaching, they begin to imagine themselves the ultimate teachings of emptiness, devoid of self-nature, in the text is called quiescent extinction, 极灭. This is another word for nirvana. So in the early Buddhist translations, they translate nirvana as 极灭, quiescent extinction. So the identity of samsara and nirvana, the inseparability, in their practice, people try to imagine themselves as being free from them. Yeah. The identity of practice and awakening, samsara and nirvana. So they, because of this confusion to the positionality of where the text is coming from, they conflate it with their own experience, and they think that they can do whatever they want. There are no transgressions, like the text says. Well, they break precepts, you know, they do whatever they want. Vexations, when they have vexation, they say vexation is awakening. So, all the Buddhist teachings becomes the means for them to perpetuate their own self-referential vexations. They're lacking humility to actually understand where they stand in practice. So there's a lot of internet trolls, the new word that I learned. Internet trolls, and there was another new word. Internet arhats. Have you all heard those terms? Internet arhats, right? And there's definitely a lot of internet Chan masters, Zen masters. Many of them on Reddit, right? This social media. You know, and they basically lambast, you know, criticize every living teacher in our current time there is. And they only kind of resonate, you know, these kind of ancient dead people, dead masters. They behave like that, you know, on the internet. This is what I called it's perpetuating self-referential vexations, lacking humility. They don't really know where they're at in the practice. Right? So I came across a few people like this, on the internet and also in person. So practitioners, genuine practitioners, who's put in the decades to work with themselves, to explore the depth of self-referential attachment, all the nuances, the subtleties, the ways in which selfing manifests. It's very easy to for them to expose, because they actually intimate themselves with all the, you know, trickeries of the mind, self-attachment, and they're sensitized to it, especially practitioners who've had insight, genuine awakening experiences. So the experience of the absence of the three poisons, greed, hatred, ignorance, vexations, and the presence of the vexation, the self, the difference is night and day, night and day. So it's going to self-proclaimed teachers, right? or a sincere, genuine practitioner, you only need to talk with them just a few words, exchange a few words, you know exactly how big their self is, this self-referential attachment. Just sense it. Nothing mysterious. Even having a cup of coffee or tea, right? Just chanting around. Kind of self-referential attachment manifest. Even without being challenged. Now, normal people, the self only manifests in an obvious way when they're challenged, when they're threatened. But even in ordinary daily life, the sensitivity of genuine practitioners, they're able to tell, able to tell. So, this section articulates Chan's position from the perspective of awakening. It is something that we cannot confuse with our lived experiences where we are in practice, because the purpose of which is to establish correct view, correct understanding. The whole passage that I've read can be summarized to "You're already free," or "It's all good." Now, just because I say it's all good, does it mean that we're actually really all good? Are we free from vexations? Do we have suffering, anguish? Do we get angry? Do we get jealous? So, modicum of humility is necessary. And even for people who have some genuine experience of being free from vexations, which is the nirvanic state, liberation, selfless, the self still comes back. So practice is continuous. Yet, the way they practice becomes very different. It's no longer driven by the polarized tendencies of having or lacking, seeking, rejecting, good and bad, nirvana, samsara. No longer motivated by that. Practice just for the sake of practice. Why? Because they personally experience the state beyond or free from self-detachment. That is what is called a person of the way, Dao Ren, a person of the way who has nothing to do, nothing to learn. It's nothing to do, nothing to learn, actually, is the technical word. It's a state more profound than just seeing one's self nature, just mere enlightenment, awakening experience here and there. No. This is a state of complete, thorough awakening. So, 觉学, or 无学, right? So, state of no more learning. Now, in early Buddhist teaching, what is that stage? arhathood. This is actually referring to the state of arhathood, not stream enter. People have experienced the nirvanic state, but you know, self comes back. They gotta continue to work. No, this is the state of arhathood. In the Mahayana tradition, it refers to eighth bhumi bodhisattva and above, in which there's non-retrogression. So, seventh bhumi and eighth bhumi, in between seven and eighth, would be approximate equivalent to arhat. So this is complete awakening. So only when a person has embodied this realization, oral complete awakening. Now, are they ordinary people? They are. So in principle, the vexations, the three poisons, and all the subsidiary vexations, Yogacara lists 20 of them. It's not limited to 20, it's infinite number of vexations vanquished. Now, practice, if we were to make an analogy of like the volcano that's within us, right? Constantly erupting, spilling out vexations, spreading the disease to other people around us. All right, this is what we do. We get angry, we harm other people, or we're jealous. That's like one stage. Someone who has seen self-nature, it's like on a shallower level, it's like understanding the volcano doesn't exist. But when they're not in that state, the volcano definitely exists. It can still spill out lava, hurting self and others. Now, that would be like a stream enter, right? In early Buddhist reckoning, you know, in the Mahayana, there's like 52, in the Chinese Buddhist tradition, 52 finer stages of practice, so early on. So the person is still very ordinary, but they have tasted in the state of liberation, free from suffering and its causes. But when the self-grasping returns, it will still perpetuate that. But when they practice, if the experience is genuine and substantial, they will not be driven by self-referential need to, you know, accomplish something or get rid of something. It becomes, in a Mahayana tradition, other-centered, responding to circumstances. The interactions with all those around becomes their path. And slowly, the top of the volcano becomes sealed. That means, isn't there a technical term? When volcanoes are dead, like lava is still there, but it doesn't erupt anymore. And to the point of no more lava or no more volcano. So there are different stages. This one, person with nothing to do, nothing to learn, no more volcano. You don't think like, oh, it's originally free. I'm originally free, originally liberated. It's all good. I don't have to deal with my vexations. No, we have to deal with them. Otherwise, we're continually hurting other people and hurting ourselves. So from that position, he articulates, what is it like? neither discards wandering thoughts nor seeks the truth. So that means, should we aspire to Buddhahood? Should we aspire to developing compassion? Yes! Unless you're fully liberated, this is what you have to do. So not to say we seek after things, try to get rid of something. There's a different term for it. Instead of seeking, we aspire. We're motivated, driven by deep compassion, sympathize, connecting with all sentient beings, seeing the suffering, and we wish to help all. So these are necessary. What about wandering thoughts, illusion, vexations? Unless you're thoroughly, completely enlightened, discard wandering thoughts. So a typical kind of popularized image of Chan Zen practice, or just Buddhist practice that I see, is some people say, you know, I sit in meditation, I need to discard wandering thought, I let them come, I let them go by myself, you know, by themselves. Neither grasp nor reject. Yes, the attitude is that of not grasping, not rejecting. That attitude is a principle based on awakening. So at the working end, we try to cultivate this. But it does not mean you can actually allow wandering thoughts to continue to arise without end. Some people say, you know, wandering thoughts, it's okay to let them come. I just don't attach to them. I just don't attach to them. Actually, it is precisely because of attachment that wandering thoughts emerge. So if a person doesn't have attachment, the mind does not wander. Mind wanders because of craving and desire. This is in all the meditation manuals, you know, from India, Central Asia, to East Asia. Why do we have wandering, scattered thoughts? Because of habit tendencies of grasping and rejecting. What is that? Attachment. So we can't say, you know, I just allow them to be, I just don't attach to them. As if you allow them to perpetuate. That's a wrong understanding. That is what I mean by confusing principle and phenomena. Confusing conventional truth and ultimate truth. You don't know the positionality. If you're practicing correctly, on the method, relaxed, embodied, freshness of each moment, you're on the method, moment to moment to moment to moment, where the present moment, the method, and the experiencing, the three are one. Where is there room for scattering, for wandering thoughts? Wandering thoughts are just the mind wandering. You're off the method. We can't have two minds, you know, one mind on the method and one mind just continually have wandering thought. That's just, you know, the mind flipping back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. The mind is like a continual chain, link chain of thought moments. Kshana, instant. Kshanas. So it's we don't have two simultaneous streams going on in our mental continuum. So if you're on the method, either you're on the method or you're not. So if a person practices properly, of course, wandering thoughts will diminish. If you practice for decades and you still have wandering thoughts, you definitely have drowsiness. Right? Drowsiness or wandering thoughts, these are the two very baby steps to one of the five hindrances of meditation. If you haven't even overcome that, and you confuse that with awakening, or you're practicing according, this is nonsense. nonsense. The five obstacles to meditation: drowsiness, wandering thoughts, are two basic ones. So if you're on the method, if you're practicing properly with correct understanding, correct attitude, correct method, and your approach to it under a teacher. And if you practice some time, you know, years, decades, you were left behind wandering thoughts and drowsiness way back. Right? So this is one example of currents of modern Buddhism, this talk of it's okay, wandering thoughts arise, just don't attach to them. This is a confusion. I see that by the rate that I'm going, it's going to be a long series of talks. I've got one sentence, right? I'll speed it up next time. We end here. This first line: haven't you seen the person of the way who has nothing to learn, nothing to do, neither discard wandering thoughts nor seek after the truth? This line embodies the state of liberation. That is the correct view. Everything afterwards unpacks it more in different areas of our practice. And it's quite useful. So tonight I'll end here. Already 9:06. I won't take questions. The video of this talk will be out soon. We can entertain some questions next time. Take care of yourself. Love yourself. Take care of others around you.